So good afternoon, all of you, and welcome to this valedictory session. So to formally begin the proceeding, I'm Deepak Phatak, by the way. I teach here in IIT Bombay for donkey's years, as they call it, about 40 years. I also happen to be the coordinator of this Empowerment of 1000 Teacher program that we have undertaken. To begin with, I would like to welcome our faculty members who helped us conduct this program. So, Professor Prabhu, thank you so much. Professor Arun Kumar, the entire initiative in the general field of engineering rather than computer science and such things alone, which are our areas of expertise, was initiated by Professor Gaitonde. When I told him that, look, we want to take this program to the broader part of core engineering subjects in all engineering topics. So he said, for mechanical engineering, I'll start off. And it is entirely due to his initiative that we see all of you assembled here for this program. So let me welcome Professor Gaitonde. Thank you so much. So, without any further ado, let me do the pleasant task of distributing certificates. I understand that these certificates do carry a small set of brownie points in your own careers. However, you will agree that that is the least of our purposes here. Main objective is that you work as the carriers of the great feeling that we are trying to contribute to other colleague teachers' lives. So I'll just read out the names and I'll request the participant to come over here. Professor Arun Sukumaran. Oh, you come from Kerala all the way. Good. I hope you enjoyed this. Thank you so much. Professor G. Nagarajan. Thank you so much. Oh, Anna University. Anna University has been a remote center for us for time immemorial. Quite some time. Thank you. Mariappan Vairavan, which Tiruchirappalli. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you. Dr. Balaswamy. Thank you so much for coming. Shiblemon, K.V. Shiblemon. Appalai, Kerala. A lot of presents from Kerala. Good. Heman Mehta from SVNIT. You didn't have to travel far for this.
Yeah, yes, good.
Rupesh Tiwari, my place, Indore. Good afternoon. Right. Thank you. Parshuram Chitragar from VPCOI. Thank you for coming. Professor K. Kannan, another old and renowned institution, PhD Coimbatore. Thank you so much for coming. Mohammed Abdul Samad from Hyderabad, Osmania, thank you so much. Professor Vittal used to be a good friend of mine, thank you. Ramaswamy Chandramouli from Shastra. I happened to pass by REC Trichy, I mean NIT Trichy and Shastra University. No, I was traveling, so I just passed by, I couldn't come in. Next time I visit there, I will come in. Yes. M. Srinivas from NIT Calicut. Koikod is called, isn't it? Thank you so much. Vijay Patil, KK Wag. Another fine institution in Nashik. It has a long record of sending people for MTech and PhD programs. You still continue that?
Yes.
Good. Thank you. Vivek Kode from Yashwantrao Chavan. Thank you, Vivek, for coming. Dr. Kumar Swami Gupta from JNTU. Which place in JNTU are multiple occurrences now, right? Hyderabad. Thank you. Mangesh Chaudhary from Vishwakarma. Is Abhyankar still around or has he retired?
He's retired.
Okay. Right. Thank you very much. Mr. Rashad Ali from Pillai. College, MESP. Oh, that is nearby. Thank you so much for coming. You have to travel at least, I think.
Yes.
Thank you so much. Thank you. VJTI, oh, I see. That is nearer. But you don't know where they live, so. Anil Kumar Agarwal from Jaipur Kukas. That is another institution which has been participating for quite some time. But you have to gather more participants at your place.
Yes, sir.
Scholars around the entire Rajasthan, get everybody there. Devi Parvati S. from Amruta. It is the Amruta technology that we are going to use later. I hope you had a demonstration or something on that. Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming. Sunil Divekar from Cummins College, Pune. It's very funny, the college is essentially a girls' college, but they don't mind keeping boys to teach them. Thank you very much. Somebody may say outright dangerous. Dinkar Ghevade from Kolhapur. Oh, KIT, the Kolhapur Institute. Yes, yes. In my Bharat Yatra, I had gone there once to give a talk. Oh, you remember? Good. Thank you. S. Suresh from NIT Bhopal. So, how is Bhopal doing? No strikes by students anymore?
No, sir.
Good, good. I remember 1969-70 when we used to have fun there. Dinesh Kumar Pasi from SGS ITS Indore. That is my college. So, what do you teach, Dinesh, as your regular hobby?
Design.
Design. Okay. Thank you. Vikas Lakhera from Nirma University. You have a fine infrastructure and fine students. I hope all teachers are fine too. Good. Dr. Nitin Ghulane from VJTI, that's the nearest spot. We expect a lot from VJTI for all Bombay colleges. Thank you. Professor K. Balamurgan from IITT Erode. Thank you. Professor Praveen Savarkar from VNIT Nagpur. Does Nagpur have a full-time director now? Who is it? Oh, Gokhale. Okay, okay. Thank you. Give him my regards. Professor Bhanu Prakash S. from Amruta, Bangalore. Somehow I have visited all Amruta establishments except Bangalore. Maybe I'll come someday there. I'll come there soon. Thank you very much. Professor Alok Chaube from Jabalpur. Oh, Jabalpur Engineering College makes it presence well. Thank you. Professor Atul Patil from RCPIT, Sherpur. Sherpur is another institution which has been with us. Somehow, although you are in a very small town, you do manage to assemble a lot of teachers from Jalgaon, Dhulia, wherever. How do you do that?
It's quite easy because Sherpur is nearby 50 kilometers from Dhulia, 50 kilometers from Jalgaon, 50 kilometers from Shahda, 50 kilometers from...
So, although you are a small point, you are the vantage point. Okay, good. Or I'll sit here and talk. This is better. It's called Angadasan. Those of you know the story where Angad was not offered any seat in Ravana's Darbar when he went there as the emissary of Ram. Emissaries are supposed to be treated well. So he used his own tail and made a seat higher than that of Ravana and sat there. The self-made asan is called Angadasan. For teachers, this self-made has an important connotation. So, I'll begin my sharing of my thoughts with this paraphrasing. You know, all life species in the world, human beings of course, are special creation of God. They have been given more intelligence and they have evolved genetically or whichever way to add an emotional layer and add a cultural layer. Observe that no other species have an institution called a teacher. Only we are privileged. And we're not privileged. Humanity understood this long, long time ago when they realized that the human knowledge was growing in leaps and bounds. And it was not possible for that knowledge to be automatically transferred genetically as it happens in other species. For example, who teaches birds to build a nest? Birds don't have a teacher, except for the hypothetical Jonathan Livingstone seagull, if you have read that. They don't have teachers. We created an institution called teacher. we said that since the human knowledge cannot pass genetically, that would have been nice, right? Your children and grandchildren will automatically be experts in heat transfer and everything. Or my grandchild should be writing Java programs now at the age of 5. Doesn't happen that way. Not as yet. Okay. So we can't do it that way. So we had this. To provide support to this institution called teacher, we created support structures. In India, traditionally they were called ashrams. But if you look at the entire human history, you take all the religious places, churches, mosques, temples, they were all essentially structures to support learning. And the priests, whatever religion, whatever it is, they would be primarily endowed with this responsibility. Disseminate knowledge, disseminate good thoughts, tell people what is right, what is wrong, tell people what skills are required. These support structures in modern day, in modern avatar, have become what? Schools, colleges, universities. But there is one sad thing that has happened. These support structures are now called institutions. National Institute of Technology, Indian Institute of Technology, such and such university, such and such college. And the original institution of a teacher has become a paid employee of these support structures. There is a subtle but extremely crucial difference in that nomenclature. You see, when I am a paid employee, my entire ethos, my entire approach to the problem is that of a paid employee. I get so much money, I will do this much work. But an institution, if you are an institution as a teacher, you will never think like that. Whether you are paid 0 rupees or whether you are paid 1 crore rupees a month, your commitment, your allegiance to that great responsibility that humanity has bestowed in you will be of a different kind. Fortunately, there are many amongst us who take that approach. You would have seen them. I was fortunate enough to study in 14 different schools when I was studying. In every school I found, without absolutely exception, at least one or two teachers who made a difference to my life. They were not paid employees. They were trying to make a difference to my life. Others probably were trying to emulate them, not so successfully. Some were clearly committed to the salary that they got. We have had teachers say, itna pagar mein itna hi padhaunga. So that is the extreme. Why I say this is, I think the time has come again to rekindle this kind of passion and commitment amongst all teachers. And we have to tell teachers that, look, whether you are going to teach for one day, 1 month, 1 year, 1 decade or 1 lifetime, whatever you do, do it with this passion and commitment. Not only you will make a difference to others, but you will make a difference to yourself also. Why I said 1 day, 1 month, etc., etc., is that you will find that many of the younger people who are joining the academics today, this would be happening even in your colleges, they don't seem to have lifelong commitment to academic program. Many have come to your colleges because probably they are not getting better jobs elsewhere. So it's a part of second choice. So they may go, they regard this as a stepping stone or as a temporary parking lot. As we say, jobs these days, and this is true for all younger generation by the way, there is no reason to shout at these chaps who come to you, but a person who joins Tata Consultancy Services or Infosys at 4 times our salary is also not committed to stay beyond whatever time it takes for somebody else to offer him 20,000 rupees more, whether it is 6 months, 1 year or something. So as I call it, a job today is not like old time lifelong investment. It is called mark to market investment. You discharge that investment the moment you get some more money elsewhere. I don't blame the younger generation for this because they come out of extremely competitive environment. They have been fighting a rat race for marks throughout their early life and then for money, for positions, for fame, rest of their life. Whenever I speak to students, I try to tell them that look, every rat race will produce some winner rats and lot of loser rats. Winner rats will have some overconfidence. Sometimes it borders on arrogance. You would have seen that. Some people who come to your college as students, you know, doing fantastically in some competitive exam, they will be sort of flying in air. We get a lot of them every year. So when I teach a first year course, one full semester has to be spent in bashing their egos, saying, look, you may be great, but everybody around you is equally great. But I am more worried about people who develop diffidence. That diffidence sometimes gets into despondence. That is where you find somebody failed and he committed suicide. There is no emotional strength. So what we need to remind these youngsters is that while you fight your rat race, some winners will emerge. So there will be some winner rats, there will be a large number of loser rats. But a rat race will produce only rats. What we want you to become is humans. And humans have something else to do. And these youngsters have stopped asking one question to themselves. Because they are always asking the following question: have I done better than him? Have I done better than her? They are only doing everything relative to someone else. The right question that they should be asking is, having done some task, independent of comparing with someone else and saying, oh, I have done it better, the right question to say is, could I have done it better? Comparison with others will eventually stink. Comparison with yourself will help you discover more and more within you, and you can do it better. Unfortunately, they don't ask this question because nobody has ever told them to ask. If they did, the answer to this question is, by the way, always, I would always have been able to do it better. Whatever way I have done, if I really think and introspect, I could find some flaw in whatever I did. And I could say, are ye achha karta to achha hota. Something like that. This is what I tell the youngsters. Now, here is a larger question. Don't you think it is also necessary to tell the same thing to our younger teachers today? Don't you think it is necessary to remind all of us also that we should continue to do this introspection? Because over the years, when we find the mahol to be like this, sometimes we also stop asking this question. Course achha padha diya, course evaluation theek ho gaya, everybody is happy, I am happy. One thing we learned very early in life, when I used to teach programming to a large number of students, you get, you know, 100, 200, 300 course evaluation forms by students. We are given those forms one semester later, so that we, you know, supposedly it will not affect on the grades of students, etc. And students give very frank opinions. So initially we used to be thrilled, oh, so many people saying excellent teaching, fantastic, yes, good, whatever. Then you notice some 15 or 16 out of those 300 forms where somebody has taken the trouble, you have not done this properly. You should have given more examples. You should have returned the answer books corrected in time. And then you reflect and you say, my God, these 15 forms contain the most important lessons. All other 250 are, they're good, they make you feel good, but that's it. They don't add anything to you. We learned very early because we had great mentors who told us, you read this, find out what you need to do. That is how we have been able to improve a little bit every time we make an offering of them. You know, when I said that teacher is an institution, IIT is one environment which retains that institutionality of a teacher to maximum extent. When we teach here, we have the complete freedom to decide what we teach, because that becomes the syllabus. We decide what questions to ask in the exam, that becomes the examination paper, and we decide what student gets what marks, that becomes the final grade, no questions asked. This is the true academic freedom. There are many autonomous colleges and NITs which are either got this or about to get it or in the process of getting it. But there is one thing beyond that autonomy of a teacher, the autonomy of the learner, which we still have to establish everyone. There is a lot to be done in education, and there is an additional challenge. The numbers that we have to deal with now are just mind-boggling. You just see the growth of engineering education in the country. In till about 1980-81, there used to be what, about 70 to 100 colleges in the entire country. You take, computer science did not exist then, it used to be electronics, and roughly we produced about 5000 electronics BE, BTECs across the country. Today what are those numbers? 50% of all people entering engineering colleges is electronics, IT, computer science, call it by some name, because they all want jobs in Infosys and whatever, whatever. To cater to these numbers, particularly cater to mindset of the students, where they are now convinced that the only thing in their life is to do better than others, you have to change their mindset. And the only mechanism available to human society today to do that is teachers, because parents have no time. That is what I would like you to carry back to those 30, 35 teachers who will come at your place. Because the number of teachers that we wish to empower, not only in the subject matter, but in their overall thinking, is mind-boggling. More than 2 lakh teachers. Most of them, large majority of them, are fresh people. Many of them have not even done their masters, forget PhD. Okay. Opportunities are less for doing that kind of activity. But you have to somehow tell them that, look, whether you like it or not, the future of this country's youth depends upon what you do. So better do a good job, and hopefully you will also enjoy doing it. So I am telling you something which has absolutely nothing to do with heat transfer, but it has to do with a lot of value transfer. And since heat has a lot of value, after all things run because the heat is transferred, I think this could further energize that heat. So I would request you to keep that in mind. This is a completely new paradigm. I had thought of this long time ago when we started the distance education program. Originally, we were trying to do it for students directly. Then we decided that it cannot reach a million students. But can I reach teachers? Perhaps yes. Earlier, it was never thought possible that you could reach 1,000 teachers at a time. In fact, people laughed at me when I originally said this. We persisted. We initially did our experiment with VSATs. EduSAT was made available to us. As an experiment, in one of our workshops, we tried to use the AVU software which Amruta has developed on a trial basis at 4 to 5 places. When we are about to conduct a workshop with the EduSAT, at one remote center, we got a frantic message 2 days before the beginning of the workshop that their antenna has collapsed, EduSAT has stopped working. Since we had introduced to the coordinators this AVU, we said, would you like to try with AVU? They used AVU and it worked perfectly well. Then, as luck would have it, the entire EduSAT stopped working, and we got a love letter from ISRO saying, I don't think they said we are happy to tell you, but they said we have to inform you that EduSAT is not working, and the next satellite may be made available to you around March 2011. I think we could guess that the year was wrong, which is what it has turned out. We then assembled our interaction with Amruta very quickly, got it done. Sajjan, who is the in charge of manager of my video team, he and his people worked very, very regularly interacting with the people in Amruta, and we got it to a level where now, in fact, the other day I addressed about 200 universities, so 200 remote centers. We are only talking about 30, 35 remote centers. There are a few things that you have to keep in mind, that at your remote centers, the audio video quality has to be excellent. So please ensure whosoever is the remote center coordinator looking after these aspects, that the internet bandwidth does not fluctuate during this, power supply, everything is in place. Because you see, we are physically here, but at that time, those 35 teachers assembled at your place will be in different places. There is a slight twist to that interaction, but believe me, it is possible. It is possible. We have almost perfected that model. Our colleague teachers from here can give lectures in the morning, but the essential interaction with those 35 teachers with us will happen via you in the afternoons when they sit down and do their assignments, do their tutorials, do their labs. And you have to make them feel as if they are in IIT doing those. That is the challenge, because I want you to imbibe not just the technology aspects here, but the ethos of this place, the The place bubbles with enthusiasm, the place bubbles with questions. This is a place where we do not at all mind when the student tears us apart and tells us this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong. We are perfectly happy with it because that we believe that we also have to learn a lot, and that is how we all learn. Now, this ethos I want you to take back. The other angle is that over the years, because of this huge separation of knowledge into various, you know, we have built boundaries. We divide first of all science, engineering, commerce, etc. In engineering now what? Mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, civil engineering, traditional. Now metallurgy, chemical, and now you have this new phenomenon called computer science, IT and so on. And these people do tend to believe, our students, that all they need to learn is this. Now, this is the first thing that you have to bash out of the heads of teachers first and request them that they should emphasize this to their students in whichever course they are teaching. Because the real life problems do not come with a tag. Have you ever seen a problem which says, I am a civil engineering problem or I am a mechanical engineering problem? The real world says, I am a problem, solve me. Now, that problem may require engineering knowledge, that problem may require knowledge of accounting, that problem may require knowledge of sociology, that problem may require anything. And we have to have confidence that whatever we know will contribute maximally, and we have to have humility to say, this I don't know, I will learn from him or him or him, and it is still solvable. Now, this message, if it has to go to students, it has to first to go to teachers. And young teachers are no different from these students. This is nothing new, by the way. These silos, at the cost of 2 minutes, I will give you an example which occurred in my own lab in 1983-84, many, many years ago. We had just started computer science program. In fact, people were transferred after they got admitted to electrical and they were in computer science then. And we had got the first PC in my lab. And that PC was the ordinary PC that was this vertical boxes here. 1 year later, somebody decided to make those horizontal lying PCs into vertical models. They were called tower models. You see all of them vertical today. What this genius had done is, he had taken those four base rods and put them on the other side, or usko ulta karke rakhi, nothing else. So they had opened this up, and that I went into the lab for 2 days, my boys were working on it. First of all, the way they had done it ulta, the power supply, which is the heaviest element, was on the top. So I asked my student, don't you see anything wrong with this? They circled around it once and said, no, no, sir, it is working fine for last 2 days. Sir, what is the center of gravity? So one of the students usko chamka immediately, ha sir, this is heavy, it should have been at the bottom. Then I also found that the fan, which was supposed to put cool air along with all the cars, because of this, the first car was blocking the airflow. So then I asked them, so what about the heat flow? These are B.Tech computer science students of IIT Bombay, some of the cleverest chaps. Remember, I told you arrogant people, they are the winning rats. So they again circled, and this time they were foxed. So I had to repeat, so what about heat flow? Then one chap says, who sir? So I said, look, these cars will get hot and they will have to be cooled. That is why there is a fan. How the fan will flow, how the air will circulate. Then the other chap, ha sir, but that is mechanical engineering problem. So look at it. A computer science and engineering student of IIT Bombay is saying that the way computers are designed, I have nothing to do with it. I shared this with Professor Gayatonde, and he was so mad, he put up in his lab, I think some 13 or 14 sensors inside it, put everything in a transparent environment, and asked an M.Tech student to do a detailed analysis of what portion of that body collects what temperature and how the temperatures will be different based on where you put the airflow, where you put the fan. If you ask me, this is simple common sense engineering, but our students are not getting this simple common sense. Back in old times when I did an engineering course, it was a 5-year program. The first 2 years were common, and I remember when I could not understand some concepts, Cochrane boiler and such thing they were trying to teach. And I tried to tell them that tell a not the teacher, we didn't have guts to shout at him, but one of the technical assistants in the lab says, "Arey, main to electrical engineer banne wala hu. I am going to become an electrical engineer." And he says, "No matter what engineer you become, you will still be called an engineer, and you have to know these things." That is when we were told by other people that, look, that is the reason why mechanical engineering is called the mother of all engineering, the fundamental engineering. Unfortunately, we as teachers are singularly failing to convey this to our students across boundaries. Now my humble request is, at least convey this to all the 1,000 teachers we will assemble. Let them think, and in their own courses, in their own lectures, in some way, let them point out that independent of what subject you are studying, you have to keep the larger picture in mind. So this is the message I would like you to take back. There is a lot that we can talk about, but as far as these 1,000 teachers are concerned, empowering them primarily in the subject that we are studying. For 2 weeks they will be there. So today it is heat transfer, tomorrow there could be some other subjects in chemical engineering, etc., etc. That subject, you have to make sure that they are not only able to teach it better, but they are able to keep this ethos in mind, that no matter what exams questions are there in the universities, after all many of them in fact definitely will be mired by the exam system. And the exam system in many universities, you know, okay, the question paper this year is not very dissimilar from question paper that appeared 2 years ago. In IIT we have been conducting JEE and GATE for how many years? Not a single question has been repeated. In my own subject when I teach, if I ever repeat a question, my colleagues will snide at me. "Hey, that question you had asked 2 years ago, how can you ask it now?" Now that is the ethos I would like you to take back. Tell them that their quality and their work will define how good the students will work. Let us not underestimate the students. Just as I was telling you about some teachers that I met, I had taken a sabbatical leave for a year and gone around the country and visited some colleges, smaller places. Without exception, in every college I found some brilliant students, without exception, smallest college. They may be, I would interact with the final year students who will be doing their project and teams of 4 or something. So I would spend about half a day, and one or two teams will impress you with the amount of thinking that they have done, amount of work that they have done. They may not be polished in English, okay? They may not be as well prepared as some of the better places, but you could see that they are passionate about what they are doing. You could see that they work. These are the kids who will change their own fate and who will change the fate of the nation. But they are all spread. They are not in IIT at all. They are not, I mean, not all of them are in IIT. Not all of them are in your institution. They are there in the small place, whether it is Jharsuguda in Orissa or Khachrod in Madhya Pradesh or wherever. Now that is the set of people we teachers have to reach. So tell them that in a class, while you will be teaching a subject, while you will be teaching as per the syllabus, keep track of 2 sets of people. One, who are doing exceedingly well. Give them some better challenge. Give them some harder problem. And the second is a set of weak students. Ensure that they at least understand basic principles of this subject. Rest will follow. The harder problems are very important. I hope you had given them some hard problems this time, or not yet? Not yet given. Okay, okay. This is, they are not living up to the IIT Bombay's reputation. So in conclusion, I will tell you one more story which has taught me a lot of lessons. I was a young teacher then. And one of the students, who was a student when I was a master student before, just 1 year before, he used to be on the chess team. So he came to me one day, he had a mid-sem paper, mid-sem examination during the, and he gave me that paper. He says, "Padak, how do you solve this question 3? That question paper was on electrical fields. A colleague of ours, great late Professor Mukherjee, used to teach that subject then. So I looked at that question paper, I could get no clue on how to solve that question 3. I promptly returned it to him saying, "I am a computer science professor." He says, "No, your basic degree is electrical engineering." So I again spent some 5 minutes, could not solve it. both of us, since I was a teacher now, both of us decided to approach Professor Mukherjee. We went to his cabin. The moment he saw that question paper in our hand, he started smiling. And as we approached, so he looked at him, then he looked at me. He did not recognize him because he was a student among 60. And he looks at me, "So question 3, huh?" So I said, "Yes, sir." He kept smiling but didn't say anything. So this friend of mine asked him, "Sir, what is the solution?" And he turned to him and said, "I don't know." And he was shocked. Then he turns back to me and says, "Patak, this is part of an unsolved research problem for last 10 years. But you know, this batch is so smart, I thought somebody will solve it." If that had happened at my own place where I did my bachelor's in Indore JSITS, college would have gone on strike, syllabus ka bahar ka sawal pucha, ye master ko pehla nikalo. But you see, that is when we learned that in real life there is no syllabus. Syllabus is actually a reflection of what human knowledge has been accumulated so far. Real life will pose different problems, there is no syllabus there. The best part of the story, and this is what I like about IIT Bombay, I would like this kind of ethos to be created in every college. That evening, in hostel 4, I think it was, these kids, there were a large number of students from that batch, and apparently this fellow had spread the news. So they were having a milkshake party. A milkshake party in IIT hostels, in those days at least, used to be a very special affair. A hostel wins inter-hostel hockey tournament, or somebody in the hostel gets a trophy for debate, some special thing happens, then there is a milkshake party. So the milkshake party was going on, the general secretary of hostel popped in. He says, "Kya ho raha hai?" He didn't know anything special that has happened. So what has happened? So one thing is, you don't know, great Professor Mukherjee says that he thinks we can solve unsolved research problem. So we are celebrating. See, that is the ethos. That is why I said difficult problems. My most favorite example to emphasize this notion of difficulty and how it is important is to ask people to speculate what would happen if they play a 3-game match with me in any, let's say, outdoor sports, badminton. All of you know how to play badminton? Fine. Suppose you are playing a 3-game badminton match with me. You don't know how I play. So you start playing your normal game, you will suddenly find me not moving at all. You see, my role model is Ganpati, you stay at one place. So if the shuttle comes my way, you will find it returned. If the shuttle falls there, I will walk very slowly like Ganpati. You will realize that in first 2 minutes, you will win hands down. First game, you will win hands down. We start the second game, I am still same Ganpati follower. Do you agree that in the second game, you will run a little less because you are far more confident? Malum hai, isko kuch nahi. And maybe in the second game, I may get across a couple of shots on you. I will still lose, but I may score some points. You would go back home very, very pleased. IIT professor ka vaat laga, you know, fantastic. What would have happened to your game? It would have deteriorated. Now imagine you playing the same best of 3 match with the world champion. Some of you may be great players, but you agree that world champion will make a mincemeat of you? The first game the world champion plays, you will struggle with all your might, the world champion, but still you will lose. But don't you agree that in the second game, you will run a bit faster, you will coordinate a bit better, and you will at least get one shot on his head, no matter whether you lose. You may go back home dejected, apna vaat lag gaya, but your game would have improved. If you agree with the principle behind this hypothetical story, then you must also agree that solving 10 simple problems in any subject can give you a lot of pleasure, but no additional knowledge. Attempting to solve 10 very difficult problems and not getting the correct solution for any one problem may leave you dejected but greatly add to your knowledge. That is what IIT occasionally tries to do, and that is what I would like you to do first to these teachers and then to these students. There should not be a single day when something unsolved is not posed to them when they are not expected to think at least for 10 minutes, maybe they will not be able to solve it. After all, what is learning? Learning is about thinking, applying your mind, getting new things. This is the message I would like you to take back. There is a lot more that I can talk of. I am trying to make some difference to the colleague community of teachers and through them to the students has been passion of my life, as has been the passion of lives of most of us here. You have seen how my young colleagues have put their time in this workshop. Don't forget that the semester is on. Don't forget that, like you, all of us here are busy. But we think that this is something special that we have to do. And together with you, we believe that we can make a difference to these 1,000. In conclusion, I'll make only two requests. We still have time till December. Try to maximize the number of participants who can come. Believe me, many teachers will apply or not apply thinking it's a normal IST workshop. They may not even understand what we are trying to do here. Try to use your personal, circle, try to use any mechanism to convey to them that here, this time, the first time in the nation, we are trying to make a difference to your thinking. You see, in spite of all everything that we do, if you assemble 1,000 teachers, maybe 60% will be charged more, 40% will not be charged. So 600 will be affected, 400 will not be, but you don't know which 600. So you have to work with all 1,000, maybe more. So that's the request. Thanks again for taking time off. 1 week is not a small time. I hope you have enjoyed your stay here, and God bless you. Thank you.
You want to tell something about the course or anything what you want to share, you are welcome to come and tell.
Thank you, sir. The efforts the IIT professors are taking are really, I'm proud of those, and really they have made a lot of difference in my thought process when I come here and through 1 week course, what Professor and Professor Arun Kumar, really they have touched the subjects very nicely, and they have made us to think a lot on various issues in all the modes of heat transfer, and really they have contributed good. Definitely, and you have charged us a lot today while before leaving this institute. We definitely will take your message to all other teachers who will be participating, and we will try our hard to collect more teachers at the remote centers and try to do the maximum work with your help. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir, all of you, sir. Since Monday till today, we had gone through the ocean of this heat transfer. So today I'm able to say that when I came over here with an opinion, yes, I know something, but it is false. So I'll say I was not knowing anything. So it is, so I'll assure Prabhu sir and Sridharan sir, from all of my participants side, saying that we will take a great efforts to make this heat transfer workshop very successful for our all teachers of all relevant colleges. Thanks for providing this opportunity to us, sir. Thank you.
Myself Hemant Kumar Mehta, I am from NIT Surat. I have never been taught these subjects in my UG life, because I think that the training makes the man perfect, and I have never been gone through that type of training. But it's been fortunate enough by this workshop that I am trained by the IIT's professors, and in a word, I would like to say that you have made us life very simple.
No, actually, we need to thank you a lot. Why? Because you are the guy who was asking maximum number of questions. Perhaps others wanted to ask, but they didn't have the courage, or they were diffident enough not to ask, but you were always, you promoted asking questions. Maybe slowly everyone opened up. So that was really nice. Although we were little impatient on and off, but for the lack of time, but nevertheless, you asked a lot of questions. That was really good.
Finally, you have satisfied us also. And thanks for the hospitality what we have been given during this 5 years stay over here. Thanks for everyone, sir. And I would like to carry the very cherished and good memories to the Surat, and I'll be planning to gather more and more teachers from our fraternity and try to make them assemble in the hall, and maybe they'll be trained by the IITs, IITians.
And by you. By you.
By me also. Yes. Definitely, it makes so much of impact to my students because I have been teaching the subjects for since long, and they have given us the vision, the subject, how to introduce the topics and how to introduce yourself, being a subject teacher in front of the students. So they have, I can say that they have changed our vision, how to introduce and how to interact with the students, how to motivate the students, and over and above, you should be very much prepared while you're going for the conducting any lectures. Thank you, sir.
I forgot that I must take this opportunity to thank my own colleagues. You might have interacted with only some of them. Mr. Sajjan Kumar Dikshit Sajjan is here. He is the in charge of our video team, and you will see his contribution in a full-blown way when the actual workshop is conducted. The entire logistics of this and other workshops is managed by a separate team headed by Dr. Mukta Atre. Mukta is there. They know you all, I think. Well, and next to her is the finance minister of our project. Jaya handles all the finance and accounts. So make sure that you remain in her good books. Otherwise, the money transfer to your institutions, etc., could be blocked any time. And believe me, she is a no-nonsense lady. She blocks me from spending some money if she does not approve the process. So be careful about the process. But she has been extremely useful sorting out all issues, all problems, and we had never had any problem with that. Well, lastly, Mahendra is here. He actually works closely with Mukta to get these things done. We have a large team of people. You would have seen the video team in action, but we have a lot of background people. We also have a lot of interesting technology developments that is happening. I don't know whether you have heard of a clicker device anytime. Kaun Banega Karodpati uses this. We had developed clickers. We used them in some of the workshops, but the first version was not good enough. Only today morning, I saw the version 2 actually getting assembled. I will be testing it in my CS101 course, and I will be requesting my colleagues to set quizzes like that. So the idea here is they will flash a quiz here and say your time starts now. In 2 minutes, you have to answer. If you are physically here, you can click and the signal will come here. But we'll be sending these clickers to your institutions, and you'll be distributing them to the participants. And we'll be setting up a receiver station in one of the PC at your place. So the logic is they show a quiz. People, those 30-35 teachers at each remote center answer it using the clicker. The clicker responses are collected by that PC. Immediately the file is FTP'd here. And in 1 minute, he will be able to show the entire audience what percentage of people said A, what percentage said B, what percentage said C. You will agree that this also works as a very important and a quick feedback to the teacher, whether I need to spend more time in explaining this concept or that. So that will become fully operational in December. This has been completely developed here from scratch. I actually wanted to purchase it. So the Americans have been using it for 5 or 7 years. I called one fellow, and I came to know that it was cost was about $30. But when he came, he said 2,500 rupees for ordinary clicker and 5,000 rupees for a clicker with LCD panel. So I gave him a cup of tea, said thank you, then went to my lab and said, develop it in 250 rupees. We have a lab called Affordable Solutions Lab. They could not do it. First version, they did it in about 700 rupees. This version costs about 1,100 rupees. But you will agree that 1,100 is much cheaper than 5,000 rupees. We are releasing even the entire hardware design, the embedded software and the backend software in open source. By the next month end, we'll have the documentation ready. So we want people to sort of, we talk about engineering and manufacturing. My dream is that some people in India start manufacturing that and sell it to Firangs at half their price and still make money. So hopefully we'll do that someday. Yes. Thank you so much.